Gentleman on my right is Mr. John Neighbor. He is a very well-known Olympic athlete himself. In fact, my friend Wes Ely recognized him immediately when I told him his full name. John Neighbor competed in the 1976 Olympics in Montreal, won 4 gold medals and 1 silver in swimming. He befriended Louis Zamperini in the 1980s when they were both enjoying some celebrations at the University of Southern California for Olympic athletes. They share those two great institutions and communities in common, and they've developed a wonderful friendship, and he's accompanied Mr. Zamperini on this trip and is going to introduce the next part of the assembly. Please welcome Mr. Neighbor.
Thank you. Thank you. Let me begin by apologizing to Mr. Joria because I did not get the memo about the jacket. I apologize. Next time I'll be sure to remember. John Williams created the music that we all just heard, and you should know that name, obviously, for all the musicals or all the music in so many of the movies that we're so fond of. I think we missed out on Jaws theme. Da-dum, da-dum. That's also a John Williams creation. John Williams also created the Olympic music. When you watch the Olympics on television and you hear the dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee, that's him. And he received the Olympic Order of the Palm. He's the only musical composer in history to get an Olympic award, and we're honored that you played that music for us today. Thank you so much. Louis Zamperini, I met him in 1983. Somebody said, you gotta meet this guy. He ran in the Berlin Olympics, and Adolf Hitler asked to shake his hand. Wow. We're both USC Trojans, we love our school, we're both Olympians, we love the Olympic movement. I shook his hand, we made eye contact, and we kind of clicked. He's a likable guy, an honest, humble, true-to-life hero, and I just was delighted to know him. We went out to dinner 3 or 4 times in the next year. We played golf twice a year together, just kind of became buddies. The 1984 Olympics, the torch relay that leads the flame to the opening ceremonies, that morning I was invited to carry the torch for 1 kilometer. And because I was America's most successful swimmer in the last 10 years, I expected a lot of people to be there cheering for me. But nobody was there. They were all waiting at the end of my kilometer because Louis was going to receive the flame and they wanted to meet him. And I felt sort of overlooked because I passed the flame and when he ran, everybody went with him and I was left with the little wimpy old torch that was burning out. 15 years later, I understood why, because only then did I hear about his World War II exploits. He doesn't talk about himself unless it's important and appropriate. And it's interesting to know that the people of Japan, in the city where he was kept as a POW, after the war, they created a memorial, the only place in the world that I know of, that honors soldiers on both sides of the conflict. It's a place to remember the fallen Japanese and the fallen Americans who fought in World War II. And in 1998, the Olympic Games came to Nagano, Japan, and the people of that city asked if Louis would carry the Olympic torch through their streets on the way to the opening ceremonies of the Nagano Olympics. CBS had the rights to that broadcast, and we're going to see a television show that they did on Louis. When they found out about this, they decided they were going to do an up-close and personal feature. And the more they dug, the more interviews they did, the bigger the show grew until it finally was about 35 minutes long. At the time, CBS was charging $1 million a minute for an advertisement on television. They gave Louis Zamperini $35 million worth of airtime. Together, let's watch $35 million worth of Louis Zamperini.
If you drove 40 minutes from the Olympic stage in Nagano, you'd come across this strange memorial. There's nothing like it anywhere else in Japan. It may not mean much to the sports fans gathering all around here, but an American Olympian of another time came here once and left a part of himself on this ground. You've probably never heard of him, but this is the incredible story of his life.
This is your life. Now, the life we are about to relive is an American saga of courage and stamina that perhaps has no equal in the annals of sports or war, from the heroes of ancient Greece to our own day. For tonight, ladies and gentlemen, this is your life, Louis Zamperini. Louis! Louis Zamperini!
Louis Zamperini never seemed destined for fame. Anyone who knew him as a kid thought he'd be more likely to wind up in trouble than on television.
Louis was a pain in the neck. In the old days, we only had one police car in town. So if it went south, Louis went north.
I started getting in trouble because of the kids liked to hear me swear in Italian, so they were always picking on me to hear me swear in Italian.
He was the son of Italian immigrants, and this was Torrance, California, a tough neighborhood outside Los Angeles. Louis never signed up for a class he couldn't skip, never saw a freight train he couldn't hop.
I started smoking, by the way, when I was 5 years old.
Torrance's police chief, Jerry Calder, knew him as a kid who was so fast on his feet that he managed to steal beer from bootleggers. It was Calder and older brother Pete who tried to convince Louis to run in another direction.
The first race Lou got in, he won and heard his name. All the guys yelled, "Come on, Lou, come on." And I guess that turned him, because it was from there on out. He had a different outlook on life.
Losing was not for Louis. He became the sensation of Torrance High School. In May 1934, at the high school state finals, he unleashed the devastating kick that was becoming his trademark and set a new world record for the high school mile.
He had an interview, and it wasn't 30 seconds after he finished the race, and he wasn't breathing. He was uncanny.
Uncanny? The second time he ran 5,000 meters, he qualified for the U.S. Olympic trials in New York City. It was July, 1 month before the 1936 Olympics in Berlin.
The city dads, when they gave me my suitcase, they had painted on the outside the Torrance Tornado. I was embarrassed. I finally got a roll of adhesive tape, and I put it over the Torrance Tornado. I didn't want to get on the train with all these great athletes, and a little punk high school kid comes in there with Torrance Tornado.
For the first half of the race, the punk high school kid was looking at the back of world record holder Don Lash. Then Zamperini pulled up right next to him and stayed there. The two ran stride for stride the final 100 meters. They hit the tape together, tying for first. Louis Zamperini had made the U.S. Olympic team. He was 19 years old. Torrance celebrated its first Olympian. Even the cops were cheering. The boy they thought would wind up in jail was going to Germany instead, to the Berlin Olympics of Jesse Owens and Adolf Hitler. New challenge, new country, new cops.
Louis was the guy who was the fun-loving guy, the rascal. He saw on a flagpole a German flag, the Nazi emblem, the swastika, and he wanted a souvenir for himself. So he shinned up this pole, maybe 50 feet in height, and slid down into the arms of the Gestapo.
And then I just inadvertently decided to run. Probably the stupidest thing I could have done, but then, of course, I'm a runner. I started to run, and I heard, I believe, a shot. I heard something crack. Then I heard the words, "Haltensee, Haltensee."
This time, the wily runner decided to halt. But Zamperini got to keep that flag. Then he hit the track. In front of 100,000 people, he started the 5,000-meter final, hoping to keep the front runners within safe distance before going for broke. But his lack of experience showed through. With one lap to go, Zamperini was hopelessly behind. Zamperini ran his last lap here in Berlin's Olympic Stadium in a staggering 56 seconds. He finished eighth, ahead of the other Americans, and was congratulated on his closing kick by none other than Adolf Hitler. Zamperini was happy enough with his performance, but saw it as a warm-up. He left Berlin confident that his golden moment was 4 years away, at the Tokyo Olympics of 1940, the games which were never held. The Olympics were replaced by a war. Zamperini signed up for bombardier training in Texas. With the rank of second lieutenant, He was posted to Hawaii, where he flew and ran, where he took flak and kept training. Any track would do. Zamperini was taking off.
That meant here at Kahuku Air Base. Yep. This was an air base back then, one of the busiest in the Pacific. On May 26, 1943, Zamperini ran a mile in 4 minutes and 12 seconds here. Hours later, his crew got a call to go out on a rescue mission, and after that, nothing would ever be the same.
The only plane available was the Green Hornet, a relic which had been stripped of its parts to service other planes. The pilot, Russell Phillips, was told the Green Hornet had passed inspection. Phillips, Zamperini, and 10 other crew members loaded it up and took off to search for a missing B-25 200 miles north of the island of Palmyra. The Green Hornet headed south to the point where the B-25 had last been heard from, flying at 1,000 feet as the crew scanned the water below for survivals.
As we circled to look for debris in the water, our number one engine, the RPMs dropped. This plane was barely flying with four motors, and with two gone, it just dropped like a rock. The plane exploded. I felt like someone hit me in the forehead with a sledgehammer. My head comes out of the water. It looks just like the world has just stood still for a moment. The plane was completely blown apart, and I could see the pilot, Russell A. Phillips, and McNamara.
Of the crew of 12, only Zamperini, Phillips, and Francis McNamara, the tail gunner, were alive. Zamperini spotted a life raft floating rapidly away from the burning waters. He swam to it, then returned to scoop up Phillips and McNamara.
Yeah, I was glad to see anybody that was moving, and there weren't very many of them.
The tail gunner, within the first half hour, he was screaming, "We're all gonna die, we're all gonna die."
He may have been screaming, but it was not an unrealistic assessment. They were alone in a raft somewhere in the Central Pacific. No one knew they were alive, and it probably didn't make much difference. They seemed destined to disappear without a trace. It was a tiny yellow speck in the Central Pacific. Louis Zamperini and his two comrades, pilot Russell Phillips and tail gunner Francis McNamara, were alive and afloat and aware that they needed a miracle to stay that way very long. Between them, they had 6 bars of chocolate and 6 pints of water.
The first night, and I hate to say this, but the tail gunner panicked, and while we were sleeping, he ate all the chocolate. A ration for 3 of us for a week. So that was all gone.
The water would now be brutally rationed. A sip in the morning, a sip in the evening. But they figured rescue would arrive before the last drop ran out. Sun and sea create delusions.
I thought, sure, very soon somebody's gonna see us, pick us up.
A week passed. No ships, no planes, no rescue, nothing. Day 10. The water was almost gone, but suddenly a plane was spotted overhead.
This was probably the most emotional exhilaration in our lives. I mean, we were actually 3 grown men. We were crying, tears running down our faces, because we knew we'd be rescued. Man, this is great. We'll be eating dinner with the Marines tonight.
The pilot never saw them. There would be no dinner with the Marines.
We went from one extreme to the other, from one extreme of exhilaration to one of fear.
They thought they were alone. That was frightening enough. Terror came when they discovered they were not alone at all.
we were trying to sleep and we felt a big thud in the bottom of the raft. We just froze. We looked down and here we see this great fin going by. And it seemed to be conscious of us, around the raft, slowly, around the raft. And then it would run to the raft and thump it. And we gave orders, do not move, don't say a word. We knew that if he had any sense at all he had to do was just bite through the raft, and he had all of us.
After two nights of dread, the shark disappeared back into the deep. Soon, the men were catching small sharks with their bare hands and eating their livers. Meanwhile, Zamperini was cooking up fantasies.
He's always talking about his Italian meals.
And I'd say, well, you know, when I used to cook spaghetti, yeah, well, how do you cook spaghetti? I'd have to go through the whole menu, you know, what you put in, how long you cook it, making biscuits. And it got to the point where this was like we were eating real food, and it got to the point where Mac and Phil would say, well, wait a minute, how much baking powder did you put in?
We'd just keep it going. What came next?
So I had to cook breakfast for them every morning, I had to cook lunch for them every afternoon, and dinner every evening, and pretty soon they got really selfish and they wanted brunch.
On the 27th day, the hum of another plane engine stirred their hearts.
Took our mirrors and reflected the sun's rays off the plane, and of course that brought him right over to us.
And then all of a sudden we heard machine gun firing. I thought, hey, what goes on here? So we looked again. It looked like a B-25, but it had a strange marking on it. It was a red circle.
A red circle, the insignia of the Japanese Imperial Air Force. Zamperini jumped in the water to avoid the strafing. Phillips and McNamara were too weak to tread water, so they stayed in the raft, pretending to be dead.
It's just unbelievable that after 45 minutes of strafing and all those bullet holes, that those guys were missed. It's just a miracle.
It took days to pump out all the water and patch up every hole, but McNamara was sinking fast. On the 33rd night of this odyssey, the tail gunner realized his journey was coming to an end.
And he just asked me the question toward evening. You think I'm going to die? That was it. You think I'm going to die? And I said, yes, I think you're going to die.
He did not see the next break of day. Zamperini gave the eulogy, and then, just after dawn, he and Phillips slipped McNamara overboard. Now there were two men in a raft, as far from salvation as they'd been the day they crashed. 5 weeks had passed.
At 2028 Gramercy Street, Torrance, California, the Zamperinis kept up a vigil for their son, even though they'd received a death certificate signed by President Roosevelt. The Torrance Airfield had already been named after Louis, and all over Southern California, newspapers mourned the death of one of the fastest men the West Coast had ever produced.
I know my mother was sure that he was still alive. My dad took it like the rest of us. We hoped for the best.
At the Knights of Columbus track meet at Madison Square Garden, they ran the Lou Zamperini Memorial Mile. In his memory, and I broadcast that race, the Lou Zamperini Memorial Mile, and I was crying during the race. The tears in my eyes and trying to describe the race. Very emotional thing for me.
There were no tears on the raft. There was no water on the raft. It had been 7 days since the last rain.
And we're ready to die. 7 days without water. The next day, we see the squall coming towards us. It's not squall yet, it's just a cloud, and all of a sudden we look up, and now it's raining. After the all-night storm, we couldn't sleep, and the next morning, just heavy seas like this, and we're lifted up on a wave, and we're looking, like we look every day, we look for land. And so this, I'm lifted high on the wave, and I see an island.
It's
not easy to imagine what goes through a man's mind when he sees land after 47 days on a raft. When they washed ashore on this beach, Zamperini and Phillips were so weak they couldn't walk. They had to crawl on the sand. But they were alive. That was the good news. The bad news? They had drifted 2,000 miles all the way to the Marshall Islands, and they were not alone. The Marshall Islands were a far-flung outpost of the empire ruled from Tokyo. And the welcoming party consisted of Japanese soldiers who dragged the two Americans to their new home. The mood was black in the Marshall Islands that night.
When they first put us in a cell, I just looked down at my knees, the bones and the skin, and I just started crying. Now here I'm an athlete. I remember myself when I was, powerful physical athlete, and now I'm just skin and bone and a skeleton, that's all. And that brought tears to my eyes.
Escape was unthinkable. The Japanese had turned these tropical islands into fortresses, all ready for the Americans they knew would be coming eventually, and not on rafts. Meals were delivered three times a day in the form of a rice ball thrown in the dirt. Water was almost as scarce as it had been on the raft, but there was no shortage of companions.
Well, I felt like there were things running around, there was, and it woke me up. I had this rat sitting right up here on my head.
To Zamperini and Phillips, it was Execution Island. Nine Marines had already been beheaded there, and the Japanese let their new prisoners know their turn would come soon.
They took great joy in telling us we were going to be executed, and they'd always go through the motions, the samurai sword and so forth. And so that was frightening. So every morning we woke up expecting, well, this is the day. This is the day they're going to kill us.
And then the day came, or appeared to. Zamperini and Phillips couldn't see the sun or the trees because they were blindfolded as they were looking. Here, at what was the headquarters of the commanding officer, a Japanese doctor was waiting for them. A man who saw them not as fellow human beings or even as Yankee prisoners, but as guinea pigs.
And the doctors and his aides are all standing there. And as they injected us, he says, now, and they had a pad and paper. Tell us every feeling you get, exactly when it happens. And then they started shooting the stuff into our veins. I said, now I feel like needle pricks all over my body. And then they kept letting the stuff go in. I said, now I'm getting dizzy and I'm gonna pass out. And then they stopped.
And then there was news, astonishing news. On their 43rd day of captivity, Zamperini and Phillips were put on a boat heading for Japan. Destination, a POW camp. Zamperini's race against death was just beginning. In September of 1943, Louis Zamperini and Russell Phillips sailed into Tokyo Bay. They were in the belly of the beast. After 6 months, Phillips was transferred to an officer's camp in the south. Zamperini had hoped to join him, but the Japanese had other plans. Zamperini was shipped to Omori, a camp built on this man-made island in Tokyo Bay. It was here that Louis Zamperini encountered the most frightful figure of his life. His name was Mutsuhiro Watanabe. He was only a sergeant, but he was clearly in charge.
Every day for 10 days, he punched me out.
This was the kind of a person you'd expect one day to take out his sword and bean you with it. Slice you down the middle, you know.
He could fly into a rage so quickly and hit out at people and froth a bit at the mouth, while he's doing it.
Watanabe spoke some English, so the POWs were afraid to call him any of the things which came to mind. The nickname they chose was the bird. Wade drew a picture of the bird.
He had a biggish head, strong face, strong face.
I couldn't bear to look in his eyes. I even when I was punished, and he'd say, look in my eyes, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. They were, to me, they were that sadistic.
The Allied prisoners thought the bird was a sadistic psychopath. His Japanese comrades thought he was, well, a sadistic psychopath.
Even among the Japanese, he was disliked. He was hated by all NCO in Omori, Japanese NCO.
Why?
No question. He was so violent.
In late 1944, Japanese officers brought Zamperini into central Tokyo to Radio Japan, and they made him an offer he really couldn't refuse. Knowing that Zamperini had a lot more star power than Tokyo Rose, they asked him to deliver a radio broadcast to the United States.
I wrote it in such a way that if my parents heard it, that they would know it was me.
On November 18, 1944, Radio Japan announced it had a special guest, Louis Zamperini of 2028 Gramercy Street, Torrance, California.
This is your voice, officer. Through the courtesy of the authorities here, I am broadcasting this personal message to you. This will be the first time in 2.5 years that you will have heard my voice.
The broadcast was heard in Torrance. Gramercy Street was stunned. But Lou's brother down in a Navy base didn't hear about it until the next day.
My roommate had been down, picked up a paper, and running upstairs, Pete, he says, Lou's alive.
A few months later, officers approached Zamperini about making another broadcast, except this time, Japanese hands would write the script. Zamperini refused. His captors threatened to send him to a special punishment camp.
My first thought was, anything is better than going back to the bird. If I get away from him, I don't care where I go.
53 years ago this week, Zamperini and eight other prisoners were put on a steam train and sent north. Didn't know where they were going, but at least they were getting away from the clutches of the bird.
And we see these beautiful snow-covered Alp-type mountains. We went right through Nagano and then went on to Noetsu.
When we arrived, we couldn't believe it. We got out of the station, and there was a big exit round gate from the station. It was full up with snow till the rooftop. Well, what the hell? How do you walk through this stuff?
The prisoners had arrived at Nawetsu, a cold, forbidding place on the Sea of Japan, just 40 minutes outside Nagano. They were taken to a camp at the confluence of two rivers and ordered to stand at attention.
Well, we just stood there at attention, stood there. Probably 10 or 15 minutes. You know, and all of a sudden the door opens up. And I'll ship the bird.
If someone had given me a pistol, then I would have just blown my brains out.
I felt probably the lowest ebb of my life. I just felt, you know, almost like it's useless.
The bestial treatment and brutal weather had already killed 60 Australian prisoners. With Japan slowly starving in 1945, there was hardly any food for the POWs. And now with the bird in command, Zamperini was entering the final stretch of his long marathon. If ever the kid with the fast finish needed a closing kick, he needed it now. One day in April, the bird ordered Zamperini to look after a sickly goat.
He said, if the goat dies, you die. Told everybody in camp, the goat dies, he dies. And the goat died.
And instead of some usual kind of punishment, he said, pick out that piece of wood. He pointed to a 4x4x6 feet and made Sam hold it above his head and just hold it there and said, wait. And then he went and sat on the roof of a little adjoining building, very low roof, you know, sat on there in the sunshine, talking to friends, you know, great fun.
In the first 3 minutes, I could hardly take it. Then I kind of went numb. And I was just frozen in that position.
And he was in agony, every muscle strained, his neck, his eyes, his head, his face.
Zamperini, all 90 pounds of him, wouldn't give in. Finally, driven berserk by the American's resilience, the bird came down from the roof and punched him in the stomach. Zamperini collapsed, the 4x4 on top of him. Wade noted the time. Zamperini had been holding that plank for 37 minutes. As the summer of 1945 swung around, the prisoners knew it would be their last summer, and not necessarily because the Americans were winning the war.
Unless we had a crop that we could have reaped, or if our banditry didn't improve, we would have been dead. That's all there was to it.
At the end of that summer of 45, the Japanese told the prisoners to write the letters POW on top of the warehouse. And there was more. They were taken down to this river for the first time to take a bath. They'd barely gotten their feet wet when an American plane appeared overhead, blinking its red light, sending a message in Morse code. The message was, the war is over.
Well over with emotion and excitement. It's just so much so you feel it's going to explode your body to get out.
The Zamperini family waited for their long-lost son in Long Beach, California, which is not far from Hollywood, and happy ending.
When I saw them, I ran up to my parents, my family. I just felt that I'd come back alive.
Right into the fast lane, trying to catch up with the time he had lost. In 1947, he met Miami debutante Cynthia Applewhite and married her 6 months later. The pace was furious, but he couldn't go the distance. Louis Zamperini could not outrun his past.
Every night, the bird came into my nightmares. No matter what other nightmares I had, he was always in my nightmares. And I was always strangling him with my hands around his throat. When he was beating me in prison camp, all I wanted was revenge. When I came home from the war, I thought, if I ever make any money, I'm going to go back to Japan, I'm going to look him up, and I'm going to finish him off.
But the only guy Zamperini was finishing off was himself. He was drinking heavily, taking a dive. His wife urged him to go listen to a young preacher named Billy Graham. One sermon did the trick. Zamperini decided to serve the Lord. How? Go to Japan, spread the word, and face the ghosts.
I was mad because I was going back to Japan, yet I was thrilled because I was in God's will. So I had those two mixed feelings.
At Sugamo Prison, he confronted many of his old guards and confounded them with absolution.
The most important thing in my Christian life was to know that I not only forgave them verbally, but to see them face to face and tell them that I forgave them.
But if Zamperini was finding the answers he needed to go on living, there remained one haunting question.
My only disappointment was when I said, well, where is the bird? I thought he'd be there.
Zamperini wasn't the only one asking that question. Among other men looking for the bird was one General Douglas MacArthur. In 1945, he drew up a list of the 40 most wanted war criminals in Japan. Number 23, Mutsuhiro Watanabe, alias the bird. MacArthur never found him, neither did anyone else. Right after the war, the bird flew up to these mountains right above Nagano,
He hid out here for 7 years. Zamperini thought he was dead. His mother thought he was dead. She built a shrine for him. But the bird wasn't dead, and he isn't. This is Mutsuhiro Watanabe, and this is the first televised interview of his life.
ビート、ケッ君というのは、白人社会においては、非常な、非常な仕打ちだと。ただ、殴ったり、ビートしたりする程度のものは、共同生活の中でやむを得ない場合もあったわけです。
Zamperini and the other prisoners remember you in particular as being the most brutal of all the guards. How do you explain that?
ミリタリーオーダーでやったというんじゃなくて、やはり私自身の気持ちから見て、フレンドにはならなかったですね。ザンパリニさんは有名な人だし、だったんだし、彼が渡辺に殴られたと。ならばキャンプ内でそういう事実があったことは考えられます。私の立場上。
But Japan didn't remain an enemy of the United States very long, and in 1952 all charges against the bird were quietly dropped. The man who made so many lives so miserable sold life insurance after the war, became wealthy. Zamperini came back to Japan a few weeks ago, wanted to meet the bird, but the bird did not want to meet him. So, Zamperini found another track to his past. There wasn't much question as to who would carry the torch through Nawetsu, the city which was once his prison. Louis Zamperini had no competition. Who could possibly compete with that smile? The 81-year-old ran for a kilometer, didn't set any records, didn't need to. He set those a long time ago.
Extremely emotional for me to know that there were that kind of people here that would erect such a memorial to prisoners of war. And when I think back to 1945 and when we left Nawetsu, it was such a horrible place in our minds, I couldn't look back. But when I leave here today, believe me, I will look back and I will never forget.
Wow.
Well, greetings from USC, Southern California. And I'd say in Rome, do as the Romans do, right? Well, that was the last race of my life, but it was a pretty slow race. But I must say it was the most emotional race of my life, running the torch. And the mayor had sent me an email, and he said, when you come to Nawetsu to carry the torch, we will line the streets and cheer you on. And he kept his word. As you can see, there was no place to stand on the curb for a whole mile. But then later he asked me to come before the city council to answer questions. And the final question came from his own lips. He said, tell me, Mr. Zamperini, did anything good come out of your being a prisoner of war in Japan? And I said, yeah, it prepared me for 55 years of married life. I don't know why I said that. I was going to say it raised my tolerance for pain, and I didn't want to hurt his feelings. But in reality, if it hadn't been for the brutalities of the bird, I probably wouldn't have had post-traumatic stress, and as a result, I probably wouldn't have gone to hear Billy Graham. So I can forgive the bird easily because I think it was a result of his brutalities that I finally came to my senses at the Billy Graham Crusade in Los Angeles, and that was the greatest thing that ever happened to me. To me, the greatest word in the world is change. Change for the better. And that's what happened that evening in a matter of moments. And when I was on my knees making my confession of faith in Christ, everything happened within moments. I knew I had forgiven all of my guards, including the bird. I knew that I was through drinking. My whole life just changed in a matter of moments. And that was the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. Now that was the first night I had a decent sleep. First time in 4 years I didn't have a nightmare, and I haven't had one since. Then I'm often asked about the life raft experience. People have said that must have been the worst thing that ever happened in your whole life. It really wasn't. The worst thing that happened to me in my whole life was when I was captured from the raft and sent to the island of Kwajalein and kept in a small, filthy cell for 43 days. That was the worst thing that ever happened to me. Of course, you saw the video and you have an idea what happened. But the most disappointing part about being captured and taken to Kwajalein was the interrogation panel of six officers dressed in white uniforms, gold braid. They had a table with a white tablecloth and all kinds of goodies and drinks and cookies and biscuits, and they didn't offer us anything, hoping that we would answer their questions properly, and if we did, we'd get something to eat. In the meantime, out of these six officers, one of them said, Lieutenant Zamperini, when you were entering USC in the fall of 36, I was graduating. Now, this guy, out of the six interrogation officers, he was the most obnoxious of the six. I couldn't believe he was a Trojan. We believe in excellency in education, excellency in sports, and excellency in morals, and this guy was a loser. But I finally had to come to the conclusion that he was a third-year transfer from UCLA. Now, I didn't make that up. That actually happened. Okay, John.
Louis, Tom Brokaw wrote a book where he calls your generation the greatest generation. But you don't like that word, greatest.
Well, you can't explain the greatest generation. It doesn't make sense. A couple of years ago, the famous psychiatrist, Dr. Maddy, who, by the way, was at the White House on the AT&T scandal, he and Dr. Yule and other psychiatrists and myself, we did a video called Stress at the Naked Edge. And we came to the conclusion that my generation was the hardy generation. Hardiness you can explain. And we were hardy because of the hardships we had to go through. We were overcomers. We had problems almost every day during the Depression, but we would commit ourselves to the problem, overcome it, and in doing so, you add to your hardiness. So to me, that's the word I use today, be hardy, and that's my trademark along with my outfit and the USC hat. No, be hardy, and I think that most of you kids probably already know what that means. And that's in regards to physical things, but also academics. You can tackle it, commit yourself to it, overcome it, and you become smarter and you become more hardier.
When the plane crashed and you swam over and rescued the pilot and the tail gunner, the pilot looked at you and said, "Louis, I'm glad it was you, that you survived." Why was he so glad it was you? What did you have?
Well, yeah, Phil, when I popped up after about 3 minutes, he said, "Lou, I'm sure glad it was you." Well, the reason he said that is because I was the only crew member that had a lifetime of survival training. And I think the first survival training a young person can have is becoming an Eagle Scout, because you go through every phase of life and you have to complete each merit badge. And when you're through with and become an Eagle Scout, yes, you're qualified for almost anything. Then I've taken courses in survival on land and sea and in the air, and glacier climbing. I was climbing a 14,000-foot glacier, and then I climbed it again 2 days later and skied it. And so on top of a glacier, if you're caught in a blizzard, you know, you're probably dead. And up Mount Hood, every year they lose two guys. This year they lost two, and last year they lost two. These guys were climbing a glacier only 10,000 feet high. But the family said, "Well, we're not worried about them because they're experienced climbers." Well, that doesn't mean a human being is an experienced climber. Have they had survival training? No. And there's just simple little things that can save your life on a glacier. For instance, when you get to the top and there's a blizzard, they say, "Well, build a snow cave and back into it." Well, that prevents the chill factor from hitting you, but you're still emitting heat from your body, and you can still freeze and fall asleep and die. Well, what I take with me is a little packet, weighs about 3 ounces, that Disney gives you when you ride the water ride to keep you from getting wet. That weighs nothing. I put that in my backpack, and then also my backpack, I put in a woman's shower hat I can pick up in any hotel. And when you get to the top of the glacier and in a blizzard, you dig a snow cave back into it, put on that plastic cloak, and that will keep the heat in your body. Now you got a hat on your head that is porous, so you lose heat out of your hat. Put on the woman's shower hat, and hey, you can stay there all night, and you'll be alive in the morning.
Clearly, he's got the "Be Prepared" motto from the Scouts down pat. When you were on Hawaii before the plane crashed, the military provided survival training for 25,000 soldiers, and yet you were only one of 15 individuals who came and took the course.
Yeah, that's amazing. You got Army, Navy, and Marines in Hawaii, and they had an announcement at all the bases that there would be a special course on survival at a hotel in Honolulu. And I got there early, hoping to be able to find a seat, and there was nobody there. There were 15 of us out of 28,000, and I took that survival course. It was mainly on how to deal with sharks, and that was a godsend for me, and not a life raft for my two buddies. So whenever you have a chance to study any kind of survival course, land, sea, or in the air, take the course. You can't get too much knowledge on survival.
Tell us about what it was like to be in a raft with the sharks swimming around the raft.
Well, on the life raft, for some reason, there's always two sharks. I don't know why there's always two, but two of them, all they do is circle the raft all day long, waiting for a handout. And now we caught an albatross, and we tried to eat it. We opened it up, and couldn't stand the smell. So we just took the breast muscle to use it for bait. Well, that didn't do any good because the sharks are hungry. They grab the bait, they tear the line, they got our hooks, they got the bait. And it was hard to catch a fish. And this happened every day, and finally, after another week, we caught another albatross, and we tried to eat that one. Well, we were a little hungrier, and we were able to bite into the breast, and had a obnoxious meal out of that. But then another week goes by. We caught our third albatross, and by now we were starving. And I'll tell you, it tasted like a hot fudge sundae with nuts and whipped cream on it.
But then the sharks tried to jump into the boat. Tell us that story.
Well, the sharks are so unpredictable, you don't know what they're going to do. And they'd circle the raft every day. The pilot and tail gunner were sleeping. And I'm watching the sharks glide through the water gracefully. And I had nothing to do, so I thought I'd just put my hand over the shark's head as he went by and rope over his dorsal fin. And so it worked. I did that, and I felt like I'm one with nature. And then the other shark came around. He did the same thing with him. And then the weirdest thing happened. They both disappeared. And I've never seen that happen before. They just circled the raft. So I'm on my knees trying to see if I could spot the sharks. They're nowhere to be found. And then all of a sudden, one comes straight up out of the water, straight at my face like a demon out of hell, you might say, mouth wide open. And now their nose turns up on the end. Their nose is about a foot, 10 inches to a foot from their mouth. And so when they go to bite you, they turn their nose up. Well, I inadvertently just shoved against his nose, pushed him back in the water. The tail gunner woke up. We saw what was happening. He grabbed an oar. I grabbed an oar. And for the next 10 minutes, these sharks just kept trying to jump in the raft. And we kept warding them off with the oars until they finally gave up and disappeared. Well, I'll tell you, that was frightening, and it was also, made me mad. And being Italian, I had to get even. And so I waited till the next day. Sharks came around again, and we looked for a small shark. And the smallest shark I could find was about 5 feet. So I grabbed his tail and tried to pull him back into the raft, but I didn't get his tail out of the water quick enough, and he pulled me into the water. And I did get out pretty quick. So then I waited another 2 or 3 hours, and finally a smaller shark, about 4.5 feet long, came by. But I realized I had to get his tail out of the water so he couldn't propel. And so I had the tail gunner with a parachute flare cartridge. When you pull a shark out of the water, the minute you pull them out, their mouth opens up. And they keep it open until you put something in their mouth, and then they clamp down on it. So we had a parachute flare cartridge. And I told Mac, I said, as soon as I get us in the raft, he'll open his mouth, and we don't want him to bite the raft, so stick the cartridge in quickly. So I did pull him out of the water, got his tail out as fast as I could, and the cartridge in his mouth, he clamped down. And now we didn't have a knife. I don't know why we didn't have a knife aboard. The raft was inadequate as far as survival was concerned. It even had a patching kit for patching the rubber, like a bicycle patching kit, but you need something to rough up the rubber with. Well, they put in sandpaper. Well, sandpaper and water don't mix, so the sand was on the bottom of the kit. So this was a totally inadequate life raft. That's pretty much the beginning of the war. And we were actually looking around for the trademark on the raft to see if it was made in Japan or Germany. But finally, not having a knife, how are you going to open the shark up? They are tough. The belly of a shark is tough. We had a mirror we used for reflecting, for rescue. So now we did have a pair of pliers aboard. But after 47 days, we still didn't know what the pliers were for. We needed a knife. So I took the mirror and I made 3 big teeth on the edge of the mirror. And I could rip your arm from shoulder to elbow with one swish. And yet it took me about 20 minutes to open up that shark's belly. Now, what I learned in survival school was that a shark liver is 20% of the shark. We all knew before World War II that all your vitamin pills in the old days were made from shark liver. So 20% of the shark is liver, and it's loaded with vitamins and minerals and protein. That would be the best meal we could ever hope for. And we finally got him open, and we divided the liver up, and we had a wonderful bloody meal of shark liver. The rest of the shark is, it smells like ammonia. We just threw it in the water and let the other sharks have it. So that happened twice, and so I felt that was probably the most nourishing meal we ever had on the life raft.
There's a lesson to take out of that. It's how resourceful this man was in solving problems that would stymie anybody else. And that's what he refers to when he talks about hardiness. By your show of hands, how many of you have read Unbroken? Look at this one.
Wow.
Isn't that wonderful? And by your other show of hands, how many of you have read Louis's autobiography, Devil at My Heels? Okay, well, there's something to look forward to. That's nice. Louis does not have time to personally autograph your books, but he did bring some bookmarks that have his picture and his genuine autograph, and it says Be Hardy on it. So hopefully, at the end of the day, you'll want to take one of those home with you for a small liberal price. I'm an Olympian. I want to hear an Olympic story. Tell us about the day after you met Adolf Hitler.
Well, the day after I met Adolf Hitler, whom we considered a dangerous comedian.
Because he looked like Charlie Chaplin, right, with the little mustache.
Yeah. But I'm in Berlin, and my buddy and I were in a beer automat, had the smallest beer in Germany was a liter. And that was too much for me, and I'm walking down the street, and I got a little brave, and I saw the chancellery, and I saw Hitler pull up in his limousine with another officer. Then on the front, there were two guards marching from corner to the center of the gate, and they'd salute, turn around, and march to the corner. And there was a German swastika on the wall, and that I wanted. I mean, everybody was picking up souvenirs, and I wanted to have the best souvenir of all. And so I timed the guards, and I realized I had plenty of time to get across the street, get the flag, and get away before they could see me. But when I had my chance, dashed across the street, I reached up, and the flag was about a foot higher than I had anticipated. And in the meantime, the guards did reach the corner, and they began to scream and shout, in German, no doubt. And so I jumped as high as I could and barely clutched the flag in my hand, ripped it from the wall, and then I did what I do best. I started to run. And then I heard a rifle shot. Then I heard the words, halt and see, halt and see. And so I stopped, the guards came up, and they treated me rather rudely until they saw the American flag and the Olympic circles, and then they held me a little more gently. And then the one guard says, why did you tear down the swastika? Very poor English, but I understood him. And I said, I just wanted to take the flag home to America with me to always remind me of the wonderful time I had in your country. I got the flag, I still have it.
You are a very, very clever young man. Tell us about Jesse Owens. He was a roommate. What kind of a guy was he?
Yeah, Jesse was, well, let's put it this way. Hitler came into the stadium, and it was mandatory that his people stand up and cheer him. Now, he had turned all of Germany against the Jews and blacks. And yet, when Jesse Owens came into the stadium, he got twice the ovation as Hitler got, and Hitler didn't like that, and so he turned his back completely on the black athletes. But then he was told by the Olympic Committee that you either greet one athlete or all of them. You don't show any favoritism, and he actually obeyed the Olympic Committee. And so he didn't greet anybody after that. And the only person that was greeted after that was myself. When I ran the 5,000 meters, well, to start with, when I left on the boat from New York, this was during the Depression, food was hard to come by. I'd never eaten in a restaurant in my life, but I was now a teenager, about 18, 19 years old, and I qualify for the Olympics. The Olympic Committee takes over, they give you clothing, put you up in the hotel, and then the day of departure, they put you aboard this big ocean vessel, and the first meal I sat down to, I couldn't believe what was happening. They kept bringing food. right during the Depression, it was hard to come by food. You had to go out and half the time shoot your food, shooting rabbits or ducks at the slough for dinner. And I tell you, I couldn't begin to understand all this food was coming one after the other, so I decided to get my gold medal eating, and that's what I did. I gained 14 pounds, on the boat going to Europe. And when I got there, I found this beautiful big semicircle building, two stories high, with many doors, and those were doors to a different country's cuisine or restaurant. So I decided to try them all, and so I never had a chance to lose my weight. So I got in the 5,000 meters, qualified for the finals, but when the I was hopelessly behind because the pace was too fast for me. The last lap, the Finns and there were about seven guys ahead of us, about 50 yards. I'm in the second pack, 50 yards behind. The last lap comes and I'm bushed. But my brother, having been a coach, he always taught me that all the athletes are tired that last lap. He says, what you got to do is open up and just run your guts out. He says, isn't 1 minute of pain worth a lifetime of glory? So I sprinted the last lap, and it was in what they called a blistering 56 seconds. And they'd never heard of that. So I was famous for my last lap. So when I got back to the grandstand, an officer came over and said, Hitler wants to see you. I said, hey, I didn't win a gold. He said, no, but he wants to see you anyway. So I went over to Hitler and just reached up and we touched hands and he just said, the boy with the fast finish. So that was my touch of fame in Berlin.
You came back from the war as a real national hero because you were famous before the war. When you went missing, they had to declare you dead. When you came back, Tony Curtis wanted to play you in a movie, and Universal bought the rights to that movie back then, but they never made that movie. And then in 1998, when the video played, Nicolas Cage wanted to play you in a movie. And they didn't do that one either. But now Unbroken is so popular that Universal bought the rights to that for a third time, and they're currently writing the screenplay. Tell us a little bit about your role in the movie.
Well, Tony Curtis read the book. Yeah, he had to play the part, but then he went off and made Spartacus, the Gaucho, and the scripts were bad. They kept postponing it. And then after the inaugural torch relay, that video was shown around the world, and I came home, and every studio in Hollywood wanted to buy it. And so we were dealing with Paramount, and Universal called my son-in-law, who is a producer and director. He's making a movie right now in Nova Scotia with
Stephen King?
No.
Pierce Brosnan.
Yeah, okay. They called him and said, hey, we own your father-in-law's life. Well, the contracts are that thick. And when I signed it, I didn't read it, but you can't read it. And in there it says they have my name for life. But he said, we're willing to pay whatever Paramount's paying. So that was nice. So we got a check for that. Then they had Nicolas Cage up. This was back in around 2000. And that went on and on and on. I never made a movie. And finally, Nicolas Cage made a movie called National Treasure. He invited all the Olympians to the premiere. And afterwards, we had a banquet. And he comes up and says, oh, Mr. Zamperini, we're getting ready to make your movie. I said, I've been hearing that since 2000. He says, well, at that time I was going to play your part, but now I'm too old. I said, in that case, I'll play my own part. So now Laura Hillenbrand is written the book. This is unbelievable. The same studio has bought the same story three times. And that's crazy. So somebody's not a very good businessman, but this time they're real serious. I've met with the producers and the directors and the writers, and then the head of the studio, a fellow named Ron Myers, he read the book and called and had a producer bring me up to his office. And so he's got about 15, 20 movies to back, but because he read the book, he's going to put a greater effort into my story, which is good.
Let's get their opinion. Right now, the script hasn't been written, but there's two actors vying to play Louis Zamperini. One of them is Ryan Gosling, and the other one is James Franco, host of the Academy Awards. By your show of hands, how many would think that Ryan Gosling is the better choice? How many think James Franco is the better choice? Oh, isn't that interesting? We will take that information to the studio. We'll let them know.
Thank you.